Good evening. My name is Dr. Nina Ahmad, and I will be your moderator for this series on COVID-19 by the American Academy of Family Physicians. We'll be hosting the series on Friday nights at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. Each week, we will have a brief status update and a guest speaker. You can ask our speakers questions before and after through the Member Exchange message board. You can also ask questions through the live chat feature. Speakers will try their best to answer as many questions as they can, and some questions may be answered through future sessions. These sessions are recorded live, so you can always refer back to them, and they're being put together based on your feedback, so feel free to comment. This session is approved for 1 AAFP prescribed credits. It's an enduring credit, so you can always refer back to it. It's also approved for 2 T2P credits, or translation to practice. And the speakers today have nothing to disclose. Here are today's learning objectives. First, we'll do a quick situation summary and then a brief literature review. We'll be going over the latest literature that has come out during the past several days and weeks. And then our guest speaker, Dr. Kim Yu, will be speaking. We'll then do question and answer and then T2P reflection. This is a graph of total confirmed COVID-19 cases for the different countries. And since the day since the 100th confirmed case, it's a projection of what's going on. You can see in red the United States, in blue the United Kingdom, and in green China. Here you can see the distribution of cases and deaths by state as of today, May 22nd, 2020. The total number of cases is over 1.5 million and total deaths 94,150. So the first study we're going to go over is about hypoalbuminemia predicting the outcome of COVID-19 independent of age and comorbidity. Most of the literature shows elevated liver enzymes of little clinical significance, and a lower albumin level is seen in severe COVID-19. Lower albumin is not parallel to the changes in ALT and AST. A retrospective cohort study looking at patients in China included adults, patients with confirmed COVID-19, and they studied the relationship between hypoalbuminemia and death using binary logistic analysis. Here you can see the baseline characteristics of the patients who were admitted, and the total number of patients in the study was 299. The proportion of men was 53.5%, and it was similar in the survivor group and the non-survivor group. The age average was 53.4 plus or minus 16.7 for the total. And you can see in the non-survivor group, it was statistically significant that the average age was older, 69.2 plus or minus 9.7. The onset time, the median onset time with interquartile range, which was the illness onset time to hospitalization, was 3 days for the overall group. And then a little bit higher for the non-survival group, which was not statistically significant. For those who went to the ICU, you can see that the non-survivors were more likely to end up in the ICU. Here you can see in the two groups, survivors and non-survivors, lymphopenia, hypoalbuminemia, and a current smoker status was statistically significant between the two groups when compared. And here you can see that when they compared hypoalbuminemia and normal albumin, that the age onset time that was median for when they had illness to when they were hospitalized, whether they were admitted to the ICU, and death was statistically significant. There was a lot of data in this article, and if you're interested in reading about it, you can see the link at the bottom. But you can see of those who had died, a total of 16 had passed away, and 14 of them had hypoalbuminemia. Then they did univariate and multivariate analysis of factors for risk of death for the non-survivors. And they showed in the univariate analysis that age, presence of at least one comorbidity that was studied, lymphopenia and hypoalbuminemia, were all statistically significant. In the multivariate analysis, they showed that presence of at least one comorbidity, lymphopenia and hypoalbuminemia, were statistically significant. They do admit to limitations that it was a retrospective study. It was at one site. They didn't look at a range of hypoalbuminemia numbers. But they did find that an albumin level less than 35 at presentation independently increased the risk of death in COVID-19 at least sixfold. And you can see that at the bottom. So the next paper was actually in the Journal of the American Academy of Dermatology, and they talk about how up to 20% of COVID-19 patients end up developing a rash or some kind of cutaneous manifestation. They bring up the issue that appropriate classification can be difficult, and currently these patients aren't seeking dermatology. They're being assessed by frontline workers, and to understand the full spectrum of COVID-19 rash, we need to appropriately describe them in the literature. So they came up with this algorithm, and they talked about when you see someone, and all of these patients with the pictures actually were positive for COVID-19. So they talk about if you see a generalized exanthem from a COVID-19 patient, to first look to see if they have vesicles or secondary crusts or erosions, and this could be indicative of vesicular rash. Then to check if the rash is blanching by pressing for several seconds, and if it's non-blanching and composed of small red macules, it could be indicative of a rash with petechiae. If the distribution was acral, then it could be an acral ischemia. And then if the pattern was a reticulated vascular pattern, it could be indicative of livedo reticularis subtype. So if the rash does blanch, then it was recommended to do check for dermographism by doing the scratch test. And if wheals were elicited by scratching, to think urticarial rash potentially. And then if wheals were not present, then erythematous rash. Of note, at the end of that, they did recommend potentially taking a flashlight picture so that if telemedicine through telederm was needed, that at each step you could present or show the picture, so it would be easier to help with diagnosis because it is difficult to differentiate. The last study actually talks about severe obesity associated with higher inpatient in-hospital mortality in a cohort of patients with COVID-19 in the Bronx, New York. And in this study, they talk about how age-adjusted death rate per 100,000 people in New York City was more than two times for African Americans compared to whites. And they tried to postulate what potentially could be the reason for that. Two reasons mentioned in this study was the prevalence of medical conditions for African Americans, higher risk for exposure to SARS-CoV-2 due to living and working conditions. And this was a retrospective study at a tertiary care center in the Bronx, Montefiore Medical Center. It included 200 patients admitted to the general medicine floor or the ICU through the ED who were COVID-19 patients and not admitted for a non-COVID reason. They followed these patients for 3 weeks after admission during March 9th to March 22nd. And here you can see that the proportion of males, the total was 200, but the proportion male was 49%. They looked at the BMI in different groups, less than 25, 25 to 34, greater than or equal to 35. And then the age median was 64 approximately, and interquartile range of 50 to 73.5. Most people were from the community. Approximately 51% were African American. The median BMI was 30. Most people never smoked, and 79% had at least one coexisting condition that was studied. So the main findings in this study were, there was a lot of data again with this, but main findings were in-hospital mortality was 24%. Only 3% of the patients were still hospitalized on the 21-day follow-up. severe obesity, increasing age, male sex were all independently associated with mortality and need for intubation, and severe obesity, increasing age, male sex, and smoking were also independently associated with increasing oxygen requirements during hospitalization. So lastly, I want to show you this article that came out. It was in Cell, and it's a snapshot of data and information coalesced in a quick pictorial that is quite helpful. We've gone through much of this throughout the series, but it's for your reference in the sources. So now I'd like to introduce Dr. Kim Yu, who's currently working as a regional medical director for Aledade, overseeing 46 primary care practices spread out throughout California and Michigan. She's also chair of the AAFP Member Interest Group in Global Health and the current convener of WONCA, Special Interest Group in Health Equity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nina, and thank you so much to the Academy for inviting me to speak to you tonight about COVID testing and what family physicians need to know about testing. This is our current stats right now, as Nina mentioned earlier, in terms of positive tests. Well, we have about 1.7 million positive tests reported out of 13.5 million tests done. That gives us a percent positive rate of about 13%. And there's obviously a large range from New York and New Jersey, where it might be over 30%, to maybe 2 to 4% in certain communities and states. The goal for WHO, the World Health Organization, has set a goal of less than 10% of tests being positive. And if you're above that, we know that you actually need to do more testing. And Harvard's Global Health Institute actually proposed that we should be doing more than 900,000 tests per day as a country. Currently, we're around 300,000, maybe even 400,000 in recent days. But we know that the bigger the outbreak in certain communities, the more testing is needed. And we won't know where we are without more testing and more data. Larry Green Center and the Primary Care Collaborative have been doing a survey for the past 10 weeks. And this is information from last weekend's, where they took surveys of over 700 primary care physicians who answered the survey last week. And we know that there are many difficulties, not only financial, but many who are falling ill themselves. And there's a lot of stress because of COVID. But in terms of testing, we know that 51% continue to have no or severely limited access to testing. 59% continue to have no PPE. And that even despite testing capacity maybe increasing to 35%, I know that for our primary care practices around the country, I've heard so many say that they continue to not have enough PPE to be able to do the testing. And so this really is a point of advocacy that the AAFP and many around the country are really asking distributors, look, we need to be able to provide PPE to independent practices, not just large hospitals that may not have the buying power of large hospitals. And so for all those distributors and big companies of PPE, please, please, please get us PPE so that we can do more testing. Of the tests that are out there, there are currently no FDA-approved or cleared diagnostic tests for COVID-19. The tests that have been authorized are under an emergency use authorization, this EUA. And why is this important? Well, this EUA actually gives a classification. There's three classifications of note, H and M and W. So when you look at the FDA website, you will see these tests, and next to the test names will be these letters. H and M stands for those that are used, those tests that are to be used at CLIA certified labs only, and the W are deemed to be used at CLIA waived. So we could use those at point of care. For the tests available via the EUA from the FDA, we know of molecular tests like the PCR tests, the reverse transcriptase, polymerase chain reaction tests, the serology tests, and the antigen tests. And again, I will recommend that you do go to the FDA webpage to look for these tests. Even as of just this past week, the FDA published a list of 27 serology tests that have been withdrawn and removed from their previous lists. So it's important to really look almost on a weekly basis to ensure that the tests that are being used in your community or used at your health department are still valid and supposed to be used. molecular tests, and we'll just go over this very briefly. We know that, you know, you're taking those nasopharyngeal swabs. You've got to make sure that you go deep enough, almost as if it's like a brain biopsy, people will say. Not quite that bad. But we know that there are issues with correct sampling and in making sure that you have enough viral genetic material, because despite the replication that makes the virus more detectable, if you don't pick up enough of the viral material, genetic material, you're going to have a negative test. There were also issues, especially early on, about storage of swabs and whether we had the right media and whether they needed to be on ice or whether they need to be just refrigerated. These issues have resolved significantly. However, there's some other issues that I'd like to talk about. The next two slides are a little bit busy, but I do want to highlight here, and hopefully you can see my arrow, of right here, this number right here, the 50 out of 50 and the 60 out of 60, these numbers in parentheses right here. And why are these important? Well, for these tests, whether they be PCR or IgM, IgG tests, when you're looking at the data, it's important to see how many tests did they actually test against positive norms. Like, so you can see here, they only did 50 out of 50 tests. They did only 31 out of 31 for the Abbott test. You know, so you're looking at data and you're wondering, is this truly a sensitive test? Is this a specific test? Is this adequate enough? And so I really challenge you to look deep at some of the data that's available. For the clear point of care tests, these are three molecular rapid diagnostic tests that are available. And when we looked at the companies that were providing this information, and we were trying to find out for our practices, as Nina said, I take care of 46 practices in California and in Michigan, and Allidade has over 550 practices throughout the country, and we were trying to figure out which machines to get and which tests to offer. These were the three that came up in terms of molecular tests, and we were really trying to figure out which one to get, and I would call, I called and emailed trying to find out information, and it was really difficult. They did not want to talk to small independent practices. They wanted to know how many patients that I would be, how many thousands of patients I would be testing. And when I said, well, maybe not thousands, maybe hundreds, you know, the answer was, we're prioritizing large hospital systems right now. And so right now, I'm not sure how available these are. But the good news is that even though two of these tests, the Abbott and the CFID test, require machines, you need a special type of machine to do the test, and the Mazor doesn't, I have heard that it has become easier to be able to get access to some of these tests and cartridges. So let's talk about some case examples here. We've got a 20-year-old male nurse who was screened at work and has a positive PCR test. He's asymptomatic, but worried he may develop symptoms and wants to know how long he should stay at home. Well, this is information from the CDC, and we know that for healthcare professionals with lab-confirmed COVID who have not had symptoms, so someone who's asymptomatic, you can do two things, either use a time-based strategy or test-based strategy. The time-based strategy, you want to exclude that person from work until 10 days have passed since the date of their first positive COVID test, assuming they haven't developed symptoms. If they develop symptoms, you move to a symptom-based or test-based strategy. What is the test-based strategy? Where you exclude that person from work as long as they, until they have two consecutive negative tests taken respiratory-wise, right? So respiratory specimens, collected more than 24 hours apart, and to have two negative results. We know that for some patients, they may have results that are positive on their PCR for much longer than 10 days. And it looks like at this point in time, even though they may be positive 20, 30, 40 days out, it's likely that those viral RNA that's been picked up does not necessarily mean that the patient is infectious or that they have infectious virus present. What about the role of COVID-19 serology? Well, according to the CDC, serology testing is really designed for broad-based surveillance and research purposes, not for individual use. And so is there a role for serology testing and diagnosis? The answer is no. The CDC does not recommend serology testing, even though a lot of companies have probably been banging on your doors and contacting you. Patients have been wanting these tests. We have to hold fast and say it's not recommended for diagnosis. For diagnosis, the gold standard is PCR testing, although the CDC does include antigen in addition to the molecular PCR tests. Again, here's the link for the FDA EUA tests that are available right now. I wanted to share this slide that shows this figure from JAMA that was published recently in May on the interpretation of diagnostic tests for COVID. And as you can see, in the 2 weeks before symptoms start, it is really unlikely that you're going to be able to pick up any virus at all. So it's not until patients actually start to have symptoms that their PCR is likely to be positive. And that lasts for about 3 weeks. And then after that time, it's likely the PCR becomes negative as the virus moves southward into the lungs and out from the nasopharynx. In terms of antibody detection, we know that it usually starts in the end, around week two, your body starts to produce antibodies. And what's really fascinating about this study is that the IgM and IgG actually rise at the same time. Usually we know that the IgM goes earlier than IgG and then falls off. And you can see the fall off that we expect around week six. And right now, IgG, you see, continues, but we don't know for how long. As for stool PCR, you can see here it is detectable and also lasts for a long time. But as previously stated with the nasopharynx PCR, that can be positive for a while too. And we don't think that it is due to positive viral particles that are infectious. So something to consider if you do have patients who do have that test. Other concerns with serological rapid point-of-care tests are that not only is it not FDA approved, it's not World Health Organization recommended for diagnosis either. And the tests actually identify more than just COVID-19. The blue box here is actually from a package insert that you'll find in most, if not all, serology rapid tests, which state basically that you can't rule in or rule out COVID infection. You need to follow up with a molecular diagnostic test, and that positive test results could be due to past or present infection with a non-SARS-CoV-2 coronavirus strain. So that's a real issue, right, with these tests. And even more so the fact that if you have a low prevalence, like in the Stanford study in April that showed a prevalence of around 2-4% in Santa Clara County, you know, if you have a low prevalence like that, the positive predictive value is less than 50%, which means 50% of tests would be false positives. So some of you are saying, hold on a minute. I've looked at the sensitivity, the specificity. They look good. They're like 90-something percent. We have other tests that are not even that good. You know, what's going on? So let's dive a little bit deeper about the biostatistics on this. Sensitivity, just a quick reminder, true positives that have a positive test. So the higher the sensitivity, the lower the number of false negatives. Specificity are those who are true negatives that will test negative. So the higher the specificity, the lower number of false positives. Both these measures are really not affected by the number of people tested. Here is all the information that when you look at, you're probably maybe inwardly groaning. Maybe you're thinking of those board exam questions that you're like, when you see them, you're wondering, am I going to get this right or not? Well, it's all here for you. And the reason I put it here is because you can actually plug in these numbers. So, you know, if you wanted to really look to see how accurate, you know, the tests are that you have, you can plug in the numbers, figure out the pretest, post-test probability, the positive predictive value, all of these things you can figure out. And so I've listed some of the preliminary performance of some of the serology tests that are out there so that you can do that calculation if you so desire. When it comes to pretest probability and interpreting positive results, we really need to figure out what is the likelihood that a positive test result is real, because it really depends on the pretest probability and the specificity. And so in the context of COVID serology, we know that if you have a high pretest probability, it makes it more likely that a positive test result is a true positive. A low pretest probability makes it more likely that a positive test results in a false positive. And so this is a really great slide. I love the slide that really shows how this really pans out. So we took a test, the ortho clinical assay, but you could take any of the tests that are available out there and you can plot this graph, you know, look to see what would it be like for a patient who is an asymptomatic patient in Kansas. So if you've got a patient like that with a low pretest probability, the chances of a false positive are 88%. That's huge, right? What about someone who's in Louisiana who's got symptoms? Someone you think is an intermediate pretest probability? Well, the percent of false positives for that patient would be 14%. Someone in New York, where we already know, you know, in asymptomatic patients, 50% are testing positive, your pretest probability is very high with a patient who has a fever in New York City. So your false positive rate is much lower. So you can see how important it is to really think of not only is this test positive, is negative, but really the pretest probability to affect whether it could be a false positive. What other factors influence the pretest probability? So we already said the prevalence of the area, the exposures to other patients with known or highly suspected COVID. If you've obviously got a patient with multiple known contacts, that increases your pretest probability. The presence of certain symptoms. So highly specific would be a loss of taste or smell and difficulty breathing. Medium specificity is fever, myalgia, cough. And low specificity, the rhinorrhea and diarrhea. Those symptoms should really cue you in and help you decide what the pretest probability would be. What's the gestalt for that patient? The number of days since onset of symptoms. If you've got a patient who's 2 weeks out from symptoms, since the start of symptoms, they would have already helped develop antibodies at that point, right? 2-3 weeks in, versus someone who's in the first 2 days of symptoms. So that would also affect your pretest probability. And what about false negatives? Well, obviously that occurs when assay, you know, is unable to detect an antibody to COVID, even though it's present in the serum. And that really is based on the concentration of the antibody and sensitivity. So when Nature Medicine did a survey just recently, and all the links to all the slides are in references that are posted and will be posted on slides at the end and will be available in the community. But I wanted to say that in this study in Nature Medicine, they looked at IgG and IgM kinetics of patients with known COVID-19 and look to see how long and how much time it took to develop these antibodies and how long they lasted. This study did not include asymptomatic patients. We don't have any idea really for those asymptomatic patients what the IgM or IgG levels are doing and how long they last. And so that really affects how we use these tests. Obviously, in the first 2-3 weeks, it's probably very not really very helpful to use an antibody test if you're going to use it at all, given the prevalence in your community. Maybe later on, it may help in some way. But by that time, your patients will probably want to know whether they had COVID or not, right? Usually in the first few days of symptoms, a patient's going to be at your practice. So you probably want to be doing a PCR test. This is a table with possible interpretation of results, and I share it because there are many iterations of this form, that this table, that basically they say the same similar information, but I really challenge you to really think, is this a true positive or a false positive? Is it a true negative or a false negative? What's the prevalence in your area, and what is your pretest probability as you decide on these interpretations? Here's another case. A 25-year-old healthcare worker has symptoms for 3 days after being at work in a nursing home and has self-quarantined for 10 days. Now asymptomatic, wants to know if he can get a test so he can go back to work. In a symptomatic healthcare professional with suspected or confirmed COVID, these two strategies, either the symptom and test-based. So the symptom-based strategy is you exclude from work until at least 3 days have passed since recovery. And improvement in respiratory symptoms, resolution of fever, no cough, no shortness of breath, and at least 10 days have passed since symptoms first appeared. In terms of test-based strategy, you want to exclude until there's resolution of fever and also improvement of respiratory symptoms and negative results from 2 consecutive molecular tests, 24 hours apart. Another case example here of a 50-year-old with multiple comorbidities tested with a serology test and was positive 2 weeks ago, but then got better. And now the symptoms are back again. And he wants to retest and wants to know if he should get another antibody test at a local urgent care. So should you do another serology test? Probably need to really sit down and figure out, could this be a false positive or a true positive? If it truly is a positive, you probably want to confirm that diagnosis by getting that PCR if he's really symptomatic and at risk of developing worsening symptoms. There are antigen tests now. Just recently in early May, last week, just before Mother's Day, the FDA authorized an EUA for an antigen test from a company called Quidel, and there are more in the pipeline. They look for protein surface antigens on COVID, and you can get fast results. However, these are nasopharyngeal swabs that are also sent to a lab. They're very specific for the virus, but not as sensitive as the molecular PCR test. So even though they may be really highly accurate if you get a positive test. If you get a negative test, you'll have a higher chance of a false negative. So if you do get a negative test from an antigen test, you probably want to confirm it with a PCR to make sure that you're not telling someone that they don't have the disease when they really do have the disease. What else is out there? CRISPR is another test that's out there. It looks almost like a urine pregnancy test, but it's genetic test that's been developed from MIT, and they're doing more studies on this right now. And the exciting thing about CRISPR is that it's able to detect really small copies of COVID virus in a sample. So it's very sensitive, very accurate. Really will be exciting to see as things move on where CRISPR takes us. What are the adjuncts to diagnosis? Well, if you've got a patient who is already sick and in hospital and maybe has had some of these tests, like maybe they had a chest x-ray because you're worried about concomitant bacterial pneumonia, or they've had a chest CT scan, we know that these were tests that actually were done several months ago in Wuhan when they didn't have access to quick, rapid testing to the volume that they needed, that many of the patients that actually would go to the hospital. And even in New York, we've seen this happen where the test results were not being reported fast enough and physicians were getting chest CT scans there in the hospitals in New York. And we know that they're abnormal in a very high percentage. However, the American College of Radiology does not recommend using these tests for screening. So it's just as an adjunct, if you happen to have these tests, if you see the ground glass or capacities, that's going to sway you more in terms of your pretest probability. And maybe you have one of these point of care ultrasounds that you have in your practice. You can actually in Asia, a lot of my family medicine and physician friends out in Asia are using these to look for B lines and that rocket sign where it looks like the rays out of a end of a rocket in the lung where areas of consolidation are, to help them inform them when, in addition to the tests that they may be doing. So guidance on who should get tested, especially since we have so many that are wanting to get tested who are asymptomatic, the CDC has outlined principles for prioritization, and those high priority patients continue to be hospitalized patients with symptoms, healthcare facility workers with symptoms, residents of long-term care facilities and prisons or shelters with symptoms, and also priority goes to patients who have symptoms just in general and patients without symptoms who are prioritized by health departments. So for example, if you have a meat processing plant or a poultry factory an outbreak at a church, something like that, where there is surveillance needing to happen. Those are the patients that really should be prioritized over someone who says that they should come to their practice just because they want to get tested. In-home kits are also on the rise, and then FDA did approve LabCorp on an EUA for an in-home PCR pixel swab kit. This is a nostril swab. It's not the nasopharyngeal swab. And they just have to fill out a pre-screening questionnaire beforehand to see if they qualify for the test. And then they're sent these tests. They swab themselves and then send it back to LabCorp. And they're supposed to get results within 1 to 2 days. I don't, at this present moment, have details on the sensitivity and specificity or how accurate this test is, but we will follow up in the community on this as we get more information. Surveillance, and you know, we could spend almost a whole hour just talking about surveillance, but I will just very briefly say that obviously there are national surveillance going on. CDC has 25 markets that it's trying to do surveillance in, and there are state and county health departments that are doing surveillance. I know that many family physicians are involved both in the county, state, and even national levels to really help with surveillance and to see what is going on in your community, whether it be because you are a public health officer or because you are on the school board, as well as being the family physician in that community. And so your role as a family physician is so pivotal. We are on the front line, and if anything, able to see very quickly if there's outbreaks coming out in our community. And so being in touch with your local health department, making sure that you're in touch with local factories or companies, large companies, maybe it is payers, maybe it is hospital systems, having that connection and being the light in your community is so vital at this time. And so I really, really want to thank every single one of you who are doing this right now. I know that there are different other surveillance mechanisms out there. There are apps that look at whether you have symptoms, and there are hospitals that are using that for whether you should go into work or not. There are also, in terms of mapping, really interesting social media. You know how I love social media, but the social media that study that's been done by Facebook and Delphi in connection with Carnegie Mellon University, where they looked at self-reported influenza-like illness symptoms that people might have on this Facebook survey. And they self-report it, and they actually publish it, and we're able to look at maps. And Allidate actually has looked at these maps and is being able to show, you know, where are the hotspots in the country. And that's been really interesting to see that on a very granular level, you can actually see areas in the maps where possible hotspots may be starting. And is it really hotspots, or is it really people with a lot of Facebook usage? I'm not quite sure. But I thought that that was really interesting. And as we move forward, surveillance will play a big part. And in other countries that are doing a really good job at surveillance, primary care is pivotal to this. And so we will see likely more and more the need for family physicians to step forward and for us to take that role in helping with surveillance. Maybe it might be getting your staff to go for training to be a contact tracer, or other things like that. So things to consider in terms of surveillance. What about immunity passports? Well, WHO has said there is no evidence that people who've recovered from COVID are protected from a second infection. And there have been cases where we've wondered whether patients actually have recurred or whether they've had a second infection. So right now, immunity passports, it's a no. There are studies that also cause concern, like this one that was done by Columbia University a few years ago, that really saw that people get frequently reinfected. And we know this, right? You can get multiple coronaviruses colds in a year, sometimes, you know, 2 to 3 times of the same virus within just a few weeks. However, there are tests on and studies on other coronaviruses, like SARS is another coronavirus, and looking at the SARS outbreak in Beijing, physicians in China there looked for B cells and T cells. And although they didn't find long-lived memory B cells, they did find memory T cells. And that could be a sign of ongoing immunity. However, you know, is it really immunity, or is it enough that it's going to cause immunity? There was a later vaccine study in mice that found that those memory T cells did protect mice, but we don't know whether that will transfer to COVID-19. More animal studies in monkeys, and so we already knew about these research that was done in China on macaque monkeys that showed that when they infected monkeys with COVID-19, a few weeks later, they weren't able to reinfect them at that time. They didn't develop symptoms. Really exciting, just came out in the past 2 days, is research from Harvard's Beth Israel that showed, and it was a peer-reviewed study that really showed, that when they infected 9 monkeys with COVID after recovery and they exposed these monkeys again to COVID-19, those monkeys did not get sick. And so their findings suggest that, you know, macaque monkeys do develop natural immunity that protects against re-exposure. The same group also tested 25 monkeys with 6 prototype vaccines for COVID to see if they produce antibodies and if they were protected. And in those vaccinated monkeys, they were protected. And so really, really exciting, but at the same time, kind of cautious, because it was only 8 monkeys that, you know, were protected or had some substantial degree of protection. We don't know if that will transpire with humans at all, whether we will develop immunity or for how long that immunity may last. But it's something interesting nonetheless. So there's still so much to learn, more to research. So what do we need as family physicians? Well, PPE is vital. And, you know, I can't stress this enough, that we need to ensure that you and your staff are safe. You also need to figure out, in terms of masks and PPE for your patients as they come in, are you providing masks? Are you giving them a mask? Are you asking them to pay for a mask? Are they wearing their own masks? Are you allowing patients to come in without masks? All of these things are important, and I think it's really vital that you address these before you start really opening up your practices. Testing, as I said, we need better validated tests, and we need tests that are free or covered. I've heard of many people who are saying they're having issues with uninsured patients, even though the government has said that we are supposed to have free testing for COVID from both insurers, Medicare, Medicaid, and those who are uninsured. So it's important that we still continue to have that. And people shouldn't be afraid to get testing just because they can't afford to pay for the test. That's just wrong. We need to also have advocacy for the supplies to be able to get the test supplies that we need in our practices, and also advocate for payment for us to be able to do the testing in our offices, because it's not without cost, right? We know that it takes time and effort to be able to have someone out in the parking lot for half a day, you know, with PPE, making sure that our patients are able to get the testing they need. So we need to advocate for that. I've already talked about contact tracing and tracking and how important it is, and how we can learn from other countries that have done very well on this, and how we as family physicians may be asked in the future to really take a part in that role. We need to isolate positive cases and quarantine. And I think back to a study actually that was really recently published by the CDC in a SNF. It was a SNF in LA. And they had 2 patients that became positive. And so they decided to isolate those patients and also test everybody at that SNF. And they found 27 other people, 19 residents and 8 staff who were positive. They quarantined and isolated those residents and staff. And they did serial testing every week. And they ensured that the, you know, for all the tests that they did every week after that, there were no more positive tests. So it is effective if you're able to isolate positive cases, and whether it be in a hotel, or whether it be at the hospital, or whether it be at their home, you have to consider, do they have other people that could be infected if you send them home? Physical distancing, masks, and hand hygiene, obviously, I don't need to say too much about that, but it's important that we model this in our practices. If patients don't see us actually doing this in our practices, it really will affect what's happening or going to happen in the community. So really important that we are models in this. Surveillance, really important to know what's happening in your community, find out the local prevalence, and really find out the stats on testing. Integration of data and health information exchanges. What I want to say there is really, do you know when your patient is admitted to the hospital or when they are discharged? Do you know when they've been to the ED? We need to know these things, and it's important that health exchanges get us that information. We also need hospitals to get us the information, because if we don't have that information, we won't be able to help take care of the patients unless they call us. Like oftentimes it's someone will say, well, it's because someone called and therefore we knew that our patient was in the hospital, right? It shouldn't be that way. And we need to work hard and advocate that we have transparency and data flowing freely. We need health departments to let us know the results of tests. I've heard of situations where health departments are taking over testing for that state or that county, and then people having problems, you know, physicians having problems trying to get results of those tests. So we need those test results. In the end of the day, it really is all about continued advocacy, both for our patients who are tested and both for patients who are really suffering disproportionately from COVID. So perhaps we need to advocate more for those populations and maybe think hard about how we can deliver care, how we can really affect change for those communities that are disproportionately affected by COVID. And we need to continue to advocate for our practices, for specialty, and for primary care. I want to say finally to thank you for all that you're doing. You, when I think of all the physicians in the country, we know that as family physicians, as primary care physicians, we take care of more than 50%, 60% of office visits in the country, even before COVID. Post-COVID or during COVID and post-COVID, we're probably taking care of more like 80, 90%, especially when subspecialists are not open. So your patients are relying on you, and you've met that demand, and you are the face of medicine to your patients throughout the country. Thank you so much. And I do want to say, you know, we are family medicine strong. We're stronger together. I thank the Academy for all they're doing. I do want to wish everybody a happy World Family Doctor Day. This past week we celebrated, and maybe this weekend as you think about Memorial Day coming up, think about the people that maybe you may have lost in your practice, or maybe even colleagues. We've lost several family physician friends and colleagues. We remember them, the heroes in this COVID fight, and we remember those who have served in our military as well this coming weekend. So thank you very much. And I'm going to hand it back to Nina so we can do some questions.
Thank you, Dr. Yu. That was a really helpful presentation and very insightful. We're going to go to our first question. But before we do that, I just want to remind members to try to think about what they learned from Dr. Yu's presentation. And you can always put it in the comments as part of our T2P reflection. And if you've learned anything, please share it so that other members can try to use the same tips that you've learned in their practice. So the first question is from Claire Reed Warren, and she asks, are these numbers actual viral testing or antibody tests also? And I think she's referring to your first two or three slides when you were referring to a set of numbers, if you can recall or want to go back to those slides.
Are these numbers actual viral testing or antibody testing? Oh, you mean the actual total number? That is a really great question, because we do not have that breakdown and we need that breakdown. So CDC, if you're listening right now, if you could let us know how many of those tests are, you know, molecular viral tests versus antibody tests, that would really be helpful. And from a community standpoint, you know, states, same thing, state health departments, we need to have that breakdown. We don't have that in all states, and many states don't have that information. So if we could have that breakdown, it would be very helpful, because it really is a different measure, right? Your molecular test is showing active acute infection. Your antibody test looking at, you know, if they're accurate, looking at past infection, either with COVID or some other COVID virus.
And then Hogai Nesseri from Facebook asks, there are lots of patients who are asymptomatic with positive PCRs. So why are they saying that detection is unlikely until symptoms develop?
Well, it's possible that even you might be asymptomatic with positive PCRs, but still after that 2 week symptoms, right? You can be asymptomatic for a long time. There are patients that are totally asymptomatic for the whole period of their disease and may not even develop symptoms. And so I think it's more that we're catching those patients after a certain amount of time. So like within the 1 to 2 weeks of symptoms, if they are going to develop symptoms, obviously if they're not going to develop symptoms, they're still going to have virus, right? That's still replicating in their system. So, and we know that patients will have that positive test.
And Jennifer Kovic from Facebook asks, for symptom-based return to work, is it improvement in cough or cough resolution?
I think it's, you know, I would prefer it to be more cough resolution than improvement in cough. Although having said that, it takes a long time, right? Even for a post-tussive, you know, anything viral usually ends up you're coughing for weeks and weeks and weeks. And so improvement in cough definitely would be helpful. But if you could get resolution, that's even better. Improvement, definitely, if they're going to be wearing masks as they go back to work, would be helpful as well.
And then Jeff Zlotnick from Facebook asks, when you get to questions, we've been seeing patients who are well over 14 days past infection but have chronic shortness of breath, so they would not pass the symptom-based strategy. Would you recommend going to PCR to confirm they've cleared the infection?
Yeah, I think you have to think about, why are you wanting to do the test? If you are not sure that they have COVID, then yes, you would do the PCR. But if you're really just, you know, if they're still symptomatic, you just wait until symptoms abate and hopefully that they get better rather than trying to do the test and when you already know that they're positive. So,
yeah. And that. And then Steven San Filippo from Facebook asks, has anyone looked at patients who may have had both flu and COVID? I had a patient who it looks like may have had both. She was much sicker than from flu alone, it appeared.
Yes, there has been multiple case reports of both flu and COVID. And in some countries, they've actually said that the co-infection rate can be anywhere from 5 to 20%, you know, and so depending on the community and the time of year and all sorts of things. So it is wise in certain communities or in patients who say they have not been immunized for flu to make sure that you get them immunized for flu so that you don't have to worry about that.
And then Seb Denuge from Facebook asks, what recommendations do you have as corporate worship services resume? Should congressional singing be postponed? Should use of masks be required?
Oh, this is really interesting. And maybe I can even pull up some information right here. I just pulled it up. There was a church in Arkansas that had a huge outbreak after they had five, I'm going to have to do this from memory now because I can't find it, but they had five different opportunities over 5 days of going to church, going to Bible studies, having a buffet, and they looked at that church, and out of 98 patients, there was a huge number, like 48 out of that became positive, and I think at least several, three died or something, you know, were really, really ill and several died. And so I would say that it would depend on where you are. You would want to really work with your health department and see what your state has really issued regarding corporate worship services. I know that many have decided to continue to do online services and that singing, the actual tidal volume and the amount of air that is, you know, like exchange when people sing should really be postponed. That group, there was another group, another church, I think it was in Georgia, that had many people fall sick from singing in one room for several hours. And even though they were 6 feet apart and they all maintained themselves, you know, distance-wise, many got sick and several died. And so masks, I think, should be required everywhere. I'm sorry, but I'm a mask. I'm used to wearing masks, you know, in Asia when we travel over to Asia. So, you know, what's the harm of wearing a mask? You know, we know that we can prevent people from getting sick, so we should be encouraging that. And if people decide to go back to church, you know, you want to protect everyone. And I will say I'm a big fan of those online services.
Thank you. So it looks like we're going into the member exchange community questions. We did have a number of questions written in prior to your talk, and I'm going to go into this one first from Vicky Roberts, and it's a multiple part question. So I'll read this to you. I hope the webinar you will address access to testing. I live in a county with one of the higher rates of infection and case fatality rates in my state. I have a patient whose son lost sense of smell and was diagnosed with COVID-19. This 29-year-old son lives with mom and grandmother. Toward the end of his isolation, both mom and grandmother lost sense of smell. Both have some coughing. Mom has sarcoid and GMA has COPD. Mom, who is uninsured, cannot get tested in our area without a doctor's visit. We don't have materials or PPE at my office. GMA was tested. Both are in isolation. Her test is still pending, monitoring symptoms and doing breathing treatments. Who pays for testing, especially in acute high-risk situations? The urgent care told her just to assume she has it, which is prudent. And that's the first part of the question.
I would say that in that situation, the urgent care is probably right that, you know, it sounds very much that if they've had a positive contact and that they have symptoms, that your pretest probability is pretty high for that patient, right? And is it going to change your clinical course if you do the test? Probably not. You're going to want to monitor that patient really carefully to see if they develop complications and as to whether they are going to need hospitalization in the future. In terms of who pays for the test, as I mentioned earlier, theoretically, an insured patient should have that test covered, but you would want to reach out to your health department and find out if they have resources available for the patient from their testing that they may have available from there.
Thank you. And then the second part of the question, the second part of my concern is the epidemiology of the disease. So many cases are being dealt with clinically and not even being recorded because the patient cannot pay to be seen. Understanding the disease in my state is already difficult because we are not provided with county by county testing rates or rates of positive negative testing. The only number of tests completed in a state number. This does not specify PCR versus antibody.
That's exactly what we were saying earlier, is that we desperately need the information from states and the CDC to actually list out whether we have molecular or antibody tests for those states. It's really vitally important. And epidemiologically, you're absolutely right. If we don't test, we won't know. And so, you know, we've got rates of testing that are a third or even a quarter of what they should be in certain states. And it's really, you know, going to take a lot of push to really get those areas tested. And so where are we as family physicians in that whole scheme when we don't have PPE, when we don't have access to tests? We need to say something and we need to speak up. And so I ask that you continue to speak up, work through your state chapter, start talking to legislators and bang on their doors and tell them we need PPE and we need tests.
Thank you. And I just want to remind, since we have only two more minutes left, that our viewers will get their questions answered through the member exchange message board if we didn't get through them. And I'll try to get through one last question and we'll go to this one that was from the member exchange message board community, Kathleen Saradarian. Who should we be testing now? In New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, they talk about stepped up testing and contact tracing, but we only have one drive-through testing site that is only testing people with symptoms. It takes 5 days to get an appointment.
And so that was that slide that I showed earlier about who we should be testing according to the CDC. And you know, it said healthcare workers and people who are in nursing homes and patients who might have symptoms. You know, at this point, it really is up to working with your health department to figure out who are the communities greatest at risk and who really need tests done. And so to be prudent with the tests that you have available, because they are limited, we can't test everybody at this point in time. Hopefully soon, as more tests are available and rolled out, that we'll be able to do more of the testing, the antigen tests. You know, they say that they'll be able to do hundreds of thousands of those tests. So if we can get those tests, I think we'll be in good shape. So thank you again, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Yu. And with that, the rest of your questions will be answered through the member exchange message board. It seems a lot of people thought it was very helpful to hear about testing. And please join us for our next session, Managing the COVID-19 Crisis, Maternal Care During the COVID-19 Pandemic. Our guest speaker will be Dr. Zita Maglore. Thank you.
Thank you so much.